Y'all gonna have to give me a brief intermission. I gotta walk to the beer cooler, and it's gonna take about 20 seconds.
What's up, HVAC crew? Welcome back to another episode of HVAC R&D, powered by Keystone Sales and Associates. We had them on last week for episode 100. They are your premier PHVAC manufacturers rep in the Mid-Atlantic. Hope you learned what that was. We do have another guest lined up for you, a local yokel, I should say. We've been battling with his mic, and actually, I got a, I'm sitting in a 100-year-old rocking chair too, because I'm moving and I don't have any furniture. So without further ado, let's get it going.
Yeah, come on.
Is there...
You like that? You like that rocking chair?
That's nice.
I'm like, shit, I got nothing to sit in. What am I doing?
The house is rocking.
Yeah, I got no furniture in this house, man. I'm moving in like 2 weeks.
Where are you moving to?
Bowel disease.
Oh, that's right. That's right. You told me that.
What's up, Trey crew? Like we said, welcome back to episode 101 after last week's episode 100 of HVAC R&D. This episode is also brought to you by Platinum sponsor One Thing Marketing, the excellent marketing people behind the creation of HVACR&D.com, which is a very nice, sleek website you guys should go check out. It's all about a podcast that brings together friends that have conversations about HVAC.
That's right. Power also, of conversation.
That's it.
Slide that in there.
Yep. So please make sure to follow us on Instagram and TikTok at hvac.rnd, as well as on LinkedIn, Facebook, and TradeHounds. Again, go check out the website, hvacrnd.com. Check out the vendor hub for more information on One Thing Marketing, Keystone Sales and Associates, as well as our deals on BetterHelp, Chirp, and Service Titan. Also, stay tuned to the live training events updates. There's going to be a lot of counter days this fall that Dennis will be at, a few of them with me, but we're going to get all those things posted up there to make sure if you're local, you come out and see us. And for any other information there, you can always check the link tree in the bios of our social media. Also, we did celebrate the top 10 all-time episodes of, well, I guess I should say our fan favorite top 10 countdown last week, as well as announced the episode 100 giveaway. It's Friday. We are still counting entrants on all social media platforms through the end of day on Sunday, which is, let me see the date, Sunday the 25th, and we'll start announcing the five episode 100 giveaways, 26th through the 30th, so stay tuned for that.
Well, so real quick, I feel like we don't touch on this enough while you hit that vendor hub. So when you go to our website and you go to the vendor hub link, we're going to be constantly adding companies to that. And it's for you guys, right? It's for contractors to go in there. If you haven't checked out Chirp Service, if you hadn't checked out Service Titan, that'd be kind of hard to believe if you hadn't checked them out. But if you go in there and click those links and you go through that through us, you will get some discounts in there. Some of that is just trying it out, right?
Correct.
So it's a good place to go try something out before you go all in on something. So definitely go check that out. We'll add more to that as we go along. Sorry, throw that in
there. No. And with that, I guess it's time to get to what everybody came to the show for.
That's right.
So tonight, everyone, as Dennis said, local yokel, we have an up-and-coming young gun in the North Carolina market making his podcast debut with us. So please welcome U.S. Army veteran, president of Taylor Air, Mr. Taylor Sane, to the show.
Every day I wake up knowing it could be my last. I ain't here for a long time. I'm here for a good time. So bring on the sunshine, the hell with the red wine. Pour me some moonshine.
What's up, man?
Yeah, what's going on, guys?
What's up?
You guys can hear me good, I'm guessing.
You can.
Redneck style over here. Got the AirPods in. One AirPod in and still talking on the computer because I can't figure it out. We do what we can.
So I was going to say, I can picture you sitting in your office. Everybody would have to see this thing. This is straight off the street, storefront. If you walked up on it right now and opened the storefront, it would just be Taylor chilling in there in his ginormous desk with his ginormous Mac screen right in front of it.
Which is pretty much what I saw on Monday when I walked in the front door.
I mean, tell us about this shop here, because clearly nobody meets there and loads up equipment, right?
Yeah, well, so my grandpa actually bought a bunch of storefront property back in 1970, and so this was actually a barber shop for probably 50 years. And then you want to talk about when I remodeled, there was like everybody's hair that was in here was probably dead for 20 years, and I was sweeping their hair up and coughing, and it was quite a time. But the barber shop actually moved over beside of this building, and me and him were shooting the crap one day, and he was like, "Yeah, I'm moving out." I said, "Well, crap, I need to talk to my grandma because I need a storefront. And, you know, there's a heat and air company right beside us. That'd look good to put another one right here." So talked to old Granny.
HVAC Row. Yep.
That's right. Yeah. It's kind of like Nashville, but a little bit different.
Right.
But yeah, so moved in here, remodeled everything, got all the hair out, well, 90% of the hair, and turned it into a— my wife actually designed it, if y'all couldn't tell that.
Oh, yeah. He's got some old, swanky furniture.
It is nice. Yeah.
Whole mid-century modern vibe. Yeah.
Yep.
Just moved in here, and it was actually cheaper to rent this place than what I was paying for a billboard. So I put a billboard on the side of the building and on the front, and I come out as a nice investment there.
There you go.
But other than the sales guys that stopped by and ruined my lunchtime and have to drink beer with, you know?
That's why I showed up after lunch.
Hey, your storefront is what you're the one on Front Street there. That's not our fault.
That's true.
Hey,
that's true.
It's Taylor.
This show is going to be so much better because I walked in your door on Monday.
I was like, man, that dude, Dustin, he looks real familiar. So I'm looking out the window because you can't see me, but I can see you. And I'm like,
right.
I'm pretty sure that's Dennis's boyfriend. I'm like, oh, yep, that's him.
So. Also, a nice feature there where you can see who's walking up.
Yep.
And
yeah.
Literally, I think you've told me and Grayson have popped in there. You've literally said you've eased over to the door and locked it, and the guy has no idea. He's just pulling on the door in.
Do that about there's some guys that decide they want to show up on Tuesday and Wednesdays, and I don't ever buy anything from them. They're nice guys and all, but it's like sometimes I'm in the middle of doing something, so I see their truck pull up, and I lock the door and run to the back, and you can hear them knocking, looking in the door, and they leave, and I'm like, thank God. So
that's that works like out four, good. That's like our fourth segment we're talking about, or maybe fifth segment when we're talking about vendors. Anyway, that's so
it. We'll get there.
It's funny you said there's a heat and air place beside you, so you put another one in. When I was in Charleston last week, I did some training at a shop, and it looks kind of residential area. Then I pulled down this street, and then it kind of turns commercial. And there was 6 heating and air companies back to back to back to back, all about the same size, different, you know, obviously different companies. And I guess that's just not really, I mean, what do you think about that? I mean, I guess it's not a problem. I mean, it's obviously not a problem, but.
Yeah, that's what I tell everybody. There's enough business to go around. I mean, I give, every day, I give probably two different people that call me different contractors' numbers, because one of them might do specialize in gas lines. The other one might do new construction. We might do change out. So, you know, I'm passing people's number around every day that are contractors in the same town as I am. So, that's, I mean, cool.
Well, yeah. And that's something that we bring up things like this on the show a lot. As you said, there's enough to go around, but you know, our industry is really big, but really small at the same time. And the last several months, I've really been working hard to kind of even start looking at my own outlook as a distribution sales guy a little bit different, because I can still be friends with other sales guys in the market. We don't have to run up on top of each other. There may be times when your buddy's got what your customer needs, but because you have a relationship, he'll help him out instead of trying to stab you in the back. Exactly. It's just doing things different.
It's a small sandbox for sure that we're all playing in. I mean, in a certain town, right? We're all going to cross paths doing that. So at the end of the day, there's plenty of homeowners to go around. I'll always say there'll never be enough heating and air guys for residential. There's just no way. But all right. So before we get too deep conversation and
beers,
what are you drinking on? Well, tell us about what you started with and now what you're drinking.
Well, funny story. About lunchtime today, the ABC store calls me and said, "Hey, man, our air conditioner's not working." I'm like, "Sounds good. I actually need to go there anyways." So every year I have to go out there and clean their drain line out. And anyways, went out there, cleaned the drain, and shopped for about 20 minutes and found some Wild Turkey Tree Shaker. It's a bourbon. Tried it out. Shaker. Pretty good.
Wild Turkey, huh?
Yeah. Well, I'm not really a Wild Turkey guy. I didn't even know it was Wild Turkey till I got it back about 25 minutes ago and started drinking it. I just saw the Tree Shaker on there. And
so Wild Turkey's not big on the bottle, like the name?
No, it's actually really small at the top.
Tried to hide that, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. It was like 50, probably $45 or something. So it wasn't like, you know, right. It was on the top shelf. So I was trying to, you know, treat myself, but it's not that bad. Pretty good.
Okay.
The first whiskey I ever drank was Cajun Joe's Wild Turkey.
I mean, was that everybody's go? First? Like, I feel like Wild Turkey was everybody's first drink. Our first really bad night. I don't know.
More like Fireball. I thought that was, maybe that's just people my age. I know you guys are about 35 years older than me. So
You came in when Fireball was strong, son.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, I don't know. It's still, if I'm at certain bars and it gets to a certain time of night, Fireball
makes a comeback.
It will make an appearance. You'll see these trays go across them. It's like, well,
I'd rather that make an appearance than Jaeger.
Oh, I'm with you that.
So Jaeger was, I mean, I'm 41. Jaeger was a big one when I was in my 21s, you know, going around. But I'm not gonna lie, man. A really, really cold Fireball is not horrible. I don't mind it.
No, it's not.
Yeah, I can't drink it cold. I gotta drink it hot.
Really?
Yeah. That's like syrup when it's cold. I can't.
It is.
Cinnamon hot toddy.
It is like syrup. It is.
Yeah.
It's
bad memories.
I try not to drink a lot of that. All right. So what do you,
moved on to?
Yep.
So I've got two more OMB Copper. They're out of Charlotte. It's pretty good beer. It's like a kind of amber beer. It's good though.
Pretty Copper. Light. Yeah. That's their staple there.
Yeah.
That's their.
That and the bottles have an awesome top that I had not seen before until Monday.
Learning something new. It's got like a, have you seen them, Dennis?
Yep.
They got cap on, they like rip it off. It's, I don't know, kind of cool though.
Yeah, that's a nice little brewery there in Charlotte. They got a lot going on.
Yeah.
I'm going a little heavy tonight on the beer. Not gonna lie. This is I did some training in Charleston last week. Kind of enjoyed that. I do like me some Charleston. So I grabbed me some Fatty's Lazy Hazy IPA. And I've seen it before. And if I'm going to drink an IPA, the juicy, I guess, the fruity IPAs seem to work. But I get it to the house and open it up and start drinking it. And I get halfway through it and I'm like, oh, okay. I turn the can around and these are 8%.
Nice.
So
get you where you want to be quick.
I mean, it don't take long.
How is the IBU scale?
I was looking for that. See if it's on here. It's hoppy, man. It's an 8% hazy is almost at the peak there of what I want to drink. But I may chase this with a Modelo. I can't drink these on this show the whole night. There's no way.
Start slurring by the end of it.
We'll have to get into something not so technical.
Something not so technical.
Yeah. We'll have to talk to Taylor about some technical
cheat sheet today. So okay. I look smart.
I'm not going to quiz it. Yeah.
You can go get Kylie's list.
Yeah, right. Kylie crushed it. What you got? What you got, Rhydon?
Well,
nobody's even opened one up yet. So there we go.
I can't leave the microphone.
That I know. Yeah, you're stuck to that. That did not. That sound like a 16-ounce can.
No,
it's a natty daddy.
It's a 12.
It's a Bud Light. Sorry.
No. 100%. Hell no. So this is one of our choice North Carolina breweries.
Oh yeah.
I drove past it multiple times last week. I always get to it. I'm like, oh, I'm going to take a picture, and then it's gone because I wasn't ready for it. Cause it always sneaks up on me no matter what happens. So I'm drinking a Hummingbird Helles Munich Lager from Red Oak Brewery. Right up there in good old North Carolina between Greensboro and Raleigh.
Yeah, it's in a little dead zone there, I guess. A
little dead zone, but had a conversation actually with somebody from there over the weekend named Jake. So, Jake, thanks for reaching out if you're listening. Dennis and I, looks like we might start having some conversations with Red Oak. So I'm very excited about that.
We're going to go chat. R&D is going to go chat with Red Oak. He wants us to do a tour of the brewery, which I'm not going to turn down. So
nope, absolutely not. We just got to figure out when to do it.
You had any Red Oak, Taylor?
No, actually, I say that.
Surely you have.
Yeah, I'm sure I have because
it's on draft in North Carolina everywhere, I feel like.
I can get a different draft everywhere I go. I try to try everything. So I go in phases where I drink IPAs and I'll drink blondes, then I'll drink lager. I mean, it changes by the week,
right?
So
if you like that copper, you'll like a Red Oak. It's got just a touch of coffee. I mean, I don't like coffee, but it has just that little hint of coffee. I live in South Carolina currently. I'm in the process of moving here in a couple weeks, but you cannot get it here. So I have got to, they don't distribute to South Carolina. So
can you get Buffalo Trace?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Actually,
you need to bring me some here because they didn't even behind the counter after I fixed the air conditioner. I'm like, you got some. They're like, I'm sorry. So this is the closest thing we got. And it was some kind of, cream that had it in there. I'm like, I'm sorry, but I can't do it. It was more milk than anything. I'm like, that's not what I'm looking for.
No.
But it's got buffalo on it.
I might could hook you up for coming on the show. I might have to hook you up.
Well, you're going to have to.
All right. Have to make a trip.
Everybody heard that.
Yep. You heard it right here first. Yeah, I'll edit that out. They didn't hear that.
Yeah, I figured.
All right. So let's get into what you got going on. I mean, I know me and you talked the other day. See, me and Taylor talk all the time, whether it's technical or just company, what's going on. And me and you were talking about it's slow right now, the weather, but it's a mental game, right? I feel like we need to get into that. I don't have it on the notes, but it was really good. Me and you were talking how when you're at a certain size, you're trying to grow, and you hit this weather season we got right now, and you're like, is it me? Am I the only one slow? You know, you go to the supply house and you're talking, like, you guys been slow, and everybody's like, no, man, we've been killing it. And it's like,
we're slammed.
Yeah, we're slammed. Are you really?
We don't want you to know we're not.
Yeah, I don't know if you want to touch on that a little bit. I mean,
yeah. So, I mean, actually, this week we've been, I know the weather this week's like 65 and raining all week, and this is the busiest week we've had all year. And so my guys are like, what crap, man? Like, it's been nice for the past weeks, and we hadn't had, you know, we're a couple change outs here and there, but nothing crazy like this time of year usually. So this week we were slammed busy, and we got tents out at every job trying to get everything done, because next week's going to be 88 degrees and we're going to be busy that week. So
hopefully.
But, right. Yeah, well, I've got stuff lined up for next week, so that's what makes you feel good. When you're going in, when you're finishing a week off, knowing you've got change outs for the next week, it makes the whole weekend a lot less stressful for the owner, at least, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yep. Are you done with your – are you done with, you know, like week's vacation yourself? Are you ready to hit it? Or?
Well,
actually,
I pretty much take a vacation every weekend.
No. I feel like every weekend, I see you all over the place, you know, camping and riding Jeeps and stuff.
Yeah. So we got out from West Virginia. I took a vacation last weekend. We went on a cruise in a couple of weeks. And then I try to take a vacation every month, because me and my wife like to travel. We're trying to hit all the national parks. So we just finished up another national park last weekend. I actually took our fathers for Father's Day camping. And then we're headed with them on a cruise. But usually we're going out west to national park. So hopefully going to go to a couple more this year. Just got to see when.
Have you done Death Valley or anything on the Nevada, California line yet?
Yeah, we've done everything in Utah. I've done Nevada, Death Valley. We flew into Vegas, drove to Death Valley in the middle of August in a convertible. I don't know what in God's name we were thinking.
We did it in May. So we did it in May. Almost as bad as August.
Yeah, so it was fun, but at the same time, you're like chugging water all day long, but it was a good time.
Now, what kind of heat are we talking about? It's not humid, right?
Well, it wasn't humid, but
is it just like radiant heat?
112.
I know, but it's just like, it's like you're just really close to the sun, right? It's not just sticky. It's just hot.
Yeah. It's not as uncomfortable as it is here with 98 degrees and 100% humidity.
Yep.
Right.
In my opinion.
But you're just like, whew.
Yeah, for sure.
Now we're gonna steer offline when we say certain things, because I just thought of something. Have you ever wrapped an air handler due to it possibly sweating? Have you ever seen that in the manual?
I have never seen that. I've seen air handlers sweat a lot in the crawl spaces that don't have good vapor barrier. Right. But, I mean, that's pretty common around here.
Now, the reason why I say that, I was talking with a guy and on the coast in Wilmington, and it is listed in some small print in the Bosch air handler manual. It says if your attic or your unconditioned space is, I don't quote me on this, I think it's 86% humidity, which I thought would be raining in the attic.
Yeah. That's kind of what I was wondering.
Throwing that out there. I have walked up on air handlers that are kind of got the mold spots all over them. You know, airflow is real big on that, but I guess they don't have that issue.
What are you wrapping?
That's a whole different
bubble wrap looking stuff, and then put some tape on it and unwrap it when you go to work on it.
I guess.
There you go.
They like said they use a type of foam board, like a. I'm picturing like duck board, I guess, type setup. I'll have to get him to send me some pictures. He's like, do I need to wrap this? I'm like, I mean, what's, I don't know. What's the humidity in the attic? He's like, well, it can't be 86. it's got to be lower than that. I mean, even if it's worst.
Both of them, the has no ridge vents in the side. It's just big holes in the side of the wall.
I don't know. I mean, I've never checked the humidity in the attic. I got to say, I don't think I've ever checked that. But I've never worked in that environment.
That's a question to ask people now.
That's another show.
How often do you check the humidity in the attic?
I'm doing an install today. The humidity is, I mean, 86.
Isn't that where you check your wet bulb? Isn't that right?
Right. There it is.
Yep.
Wet bulb in the attic.
So, yeah, so you've been, so you're busy when it's the worst weather, and that's what it is, man. We say it's seasonal until we get stuff like that. I mean.
Yeah, it's been a weird year for us so far. I mean, I hired a couple guys. Well, we're up to 5 full-time guys, and then myself and my dad actually started working for me since he retired. He's doing the permitting and all the stuff that I got tired of doing. So he kind of enjoys it. But I hired the guys at the end of last year knowing it was going to be slammed busy in April. It's like, in April, man, I keep telling the new guy, I'm like, man, it's crazy. When it gets April, it just, falls to the wall until the end of April comes. Yeah, April comes.
Man, when it gets July, man, it's going to be killing it.
It's like, man, first 90-degree day, and we're still waiting on the 90-degree day, so I didn't fib on that one. But
waiting on the third one.
Yeah, it's been kind of weird.
It's the first day of summer. I mean,
Today is?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know
that. Yeah, it's 68 degrees in Fort Mill.
I know.
Yeah. Pouring down rain.
Yeah, it's just pouring down. I don't miss that, man. I mean, work. There's only so much you can do HVAC in the rain, like pouring rain.
No joke.
You can't get your mind right. Your maintenance guys or your service techs. There's nothing worse than all the tools that I'm like super proud of. The next day, they're all rusted. Like I hate that. God, I hate that. God. Like all my channel locks, all my
I passed Roger this morning on the bridge off of George Lyles, and he was getting on the highway with equipment in the back trailer of his truck, and it was just dumping the rain. I was like, oh, your day's gonna suck, man. I'm sorry.
Not a fun time.
Yeah, I mean, I've done plenty of installs in the pouring rain. You just set your little tent up. What are you keeping in your, what kind of tents do y'all keep for your change outs?
Do not buy, and I cannot freaking emphasize this enough, Harbor Freight tents. They are terrible. Guys, so my dad owned Ace Hardware, which is right behind my office, for 40 some years. My grandpa started it a long time ago.
Right.
So I would go up there and buy everything. Well, they ran out of them, and it was pouring down rain. I said, well, just go to Harbor Freight and get a couple of them. First day, both of them broke.
Yeah,
and
just get a half dozen of them.
3 years I had the other one, and first day, both of them broke. I'm like, boys, I don't know what to tell you. Like, you're just going to have to.
Academy and Dicks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I will say, the Easy Up brand, like the OG Easy Up, it was hard to beat that.
I'm not sure what brand they actually are.
But now there's brands out now that are just fine, right? I bought one from Cabela's. Anything from places like that, you should be okay. But yeah, I had I don't know where it came from, but I had like an 8x8, which is a small one. You know, it's kind of small. That's small enough.
Yeah, pretty small.
Yeah.
For doing installs. I mean, yeah, you got to get your mind right, man, to do an install on a day like today. It's tough, you know.
It makes it tough to keep moving on those days. Yeah. You're just like, oh, no, I don't want to do anything.
Every time you got to go to the truck, it's like, here we go again.
I was going to say, we got to hear your kind of your intro. I don't think I've actually ever heard this story.
To hear a little bit. I'm excited to hear the rest of it.
Yeah, I mean, how did you even get into HVAC?
Yeah, your path to HVAC.
Yeah, so I'll start when I was in the HVAC. I'll back up a little bit from there. When I got out of the high school, I'd worked for my dad for pretty much all of my life. So you imagine how that goes. I'm sure you guys actually probably know that.
I know exactly how you feel.
And, yep, I actually do too. Yep.
Me and my dad, they get along really good, but it's just, you know, at that point in time, I was 18 years old. I got my 14th birthday, for my birthday present, I got a worker's permit so I could go work for him legally. So that was a great time.
I know that feeling too.
Yeah. So I worked for him and I was like, man, I am not doing this whole retail business. I cannot, there's no way I can do this. I hate it. So I was like, you know, it'd be a good idea. I'm going to join the Army. And, so me and my buddy, which we were both a little crazy, but, he's like, yeah, well, that, you know, the buddy system, we can go in on the buddy system. I'm like, well, that'll be cool. So sure as crap, we signed up and got shipped off, went to the Army. Then after the Army, I was like, all right, well, I don't know what I'm going to do now. I'll just go to college since it's free, you know, whatever. Right. And so a family member had actually, he was like, you can come work for me. I do HVAC, you know. I said, well, I don't know anything about it, but it's better than going back to the hardware store, so work for me. And I started, I was like, anything but there, you know. So there was a pretty rough crowd that I was working around, but it was kind of fun. And he had done it for 30 some years.
Now, how old were you when you jumped into that?
21.
Ooh, okay.
So, yeah, I was right about 21. So I worked for that guy for a couple months, and, you know, I was like, I kind of like this. You know, you're out. It's way better than the Army. My God, it couldn't be worse than sticking out in the rain for a month.
Right.
You know, I was like, the guys were complaining. At that time, they had been there and knew the whole backstory. I didn't, but I'm like, guys, y'all got it made, man. You can take a shower at night. I went freaking 3.5 weeks without taking a shower. I'm like, this is awesome. I get to go home every day. And so I started working for him, and I didn't know anything. So I just figured he knew what he was doing. And so I was just following his, you know, footsteps.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
And a couple months into it, I was watching videos and all kind of different stuff on how to do stuff in the HVAC world correctly. And I went to him like, hey, man, you know, this ain't really, you know,
how you're supposed to do it. Huh?
Yeah, this ain't really how you're supposed to do it. And he was like, well, I've done it for 30 years this way, and I'm not going to change now. I'm like, all right. Well, so anyways, I end up getting my license a little less than 2 years from when I started, because I worked so many hours, and end up going to get my HVAC license for my H3s and at 22. And so nice. I was like, I've got to get out of here. This is awful. Like, the dude was, he would tell you one thing, do the opposite. So it wasn't clicking very well. So anyways, I left and went and worked for another company. And whenever I put my resume out, everybody was calling me because I was 22 years old with a contractor's license. And
oh yeah,
people were, you know, if I send it off, it was, they were calling back and I was doing interviews. And so end up picking a dude in Gastonia, which is about 30 minutes from where I'm at now. And I was just so busy, people calling me, want me to do, you know, not side work, but pretty much side work for them.
Yeah, I mean, that's,
I was working two jobs.
I feel like that's a bad name for that in this industry, yeah. Right? Like, it's just somebody knows somebody that they need something done. And I mean, it's just,
they want to use someone they trust as opposed to call someone they don't.
Yep.
Yeah, it's not, a lot of times it's not just price, right? It's just like, man, I'd like to get Taylor over here to do what I need done. And Taylor works for a company. And
well, you know, what I did whenever I talked, when I interviewed with the guy, he was a great guy. He said, where do you see yourself in 2 years in the interview? I said, owning my own company. And he said, okay. And then 6 months into it, I started my own company. And I went to talk to him that day. I'm like, hey, man, you cool for a minute? So me and him started talking. And I said, you know, I told him before that I was going to do side stuff and ask him if he was okay with that. And he said, yeah, as long as it don't interfere with our company. And I said, yeah, no problem. And so I was doing stuff 30, 45 minutes away from his clientele. So it didn't really conflict. It was just after work. I was just so tired of working till midnight putting in systems that it wasn't going to happen. And then so I was like, well, I guess I'm starting my own thing. So I quit there and bought a truck and, you know, just put my name on the side of it, started a Facebook page. And from there, I hired what I thought was a helper, but it was more like I was babysitting.
well, same thing.
He was a good, he was hilarious. Funniest dude you ever met in your life. But man, when you ask him to do something, he'd look at you like, you really want me to do that? I'm like, yeah, I need you to crawl under the house and pull the line set out. It's like, that's part of the job. But the dude was hilarious. and I kind of felt, a little bad for him. But anyways, so then once I got rid of him, I hired a guy, two guys, and they're actually still with me. And one of them, I fired that dude.
We know audio guy.
Yeah. So when I fired him, he said, you can't replace me. I said, all right. I picked up the phone. I called the guy that had an application. I said, hey, man, you busy? He said, nah. I said, well, meet me at the shop. I'll be here in 30 minutes. That dude jumped out. The other dude jumped in. He headed back to the job with me. So it was, and ever since then, it's been great. We've been doing pretty good. And that was when I was 22. So we've been in business a little over 3 years now.
Okay. Like a lot longer than that.
Yeah.
Why does it? Yeah. I mean,
pandemic, man.
I feel like me and you have been taking tech support calls for, 10 years.
It's only been, like I said, I think it was May was actually when I first posted on Facebook, like May of 2020. That I had just quit my job because it posted the picture the other day of the shirts that I got. And I bought a truck, which now is probably worth four times what I bought it for. a 1500 four-door truck with a cab on the back. The dude only wanted $15,000 for it, and it had like 40,000 miles. So I bought that, put my letters on it, and then from there, just kind of figuring it out as I go, figuring out what works, what don't work. And we figured out that we're definitely never doing new construction, so we don't even quote that to anybody. And it's definitely not as consistent, but the reward is better at the end of the day because you're not wearing your guys out for, hardly any money.
Now, have you had any, have you had any builders approach you that are like, because I'm gonna be building a house up there and I'm looking for a guy that builds, I don't know, five or six a year, maybe maybe less than that. Have you had any builders approach you? Some guys go, yeah, we do new construction, but we only do custom. Would you do new construction if a guy was just like, just charge me what you charge as long as you do a good job?
I teach my guys, I know it's the same thing essentially, but personally, I like to go out to a job, look at the job, give the quote. We know what's there. We know what needs to be done. It's not like they're adding a porch on in the middle of our install and they want to move it over from here to here to where they're putting the,
It takes more manpower to handle it, obviously. Yeah.
And I've had actually a couple contractors come to me from the local area. They're like, hey, dude, we just need somebody that's good and reliable. We're doing custom houses, like you said, and we just need somebody. I'm like, well, still not really interested in it because I'm losing money I'm losing money by spending four times as much time, going out there so many trips, sending my guys out there, say if they by chance forgot to fire caulk, thermostat wire, they fail. Yep. We got to go back out there. Then we got to re-inspect again. It's like,
Who do you send? Right. Yeah. You don't really have in your position. And same with us, when I was in the field, we didn't have like a flunky. Yeah. The guy we were sending out there was made pretty good money. So he's going out there just kind of piddling around. And I'm with you. It's like you either got to commit and have a division for that, or you just don't do it.
Yeah. And we just chose, that was my get-go. I'm like, I will never do a new construction house. And for 3 years, the only new construction house I'd done was the one that I built for myself as a duplex, and that was it. So,
right.
It's super cutthroat around here too, because there's so many, you know, contractors that are actually.
No, it ain't just around here.
Right? No, it's cutthroat everywhere. New construction is an interesting market, and I will tell you, I'm seeing and hearing more and more of the large builders are now starting to try to even purchase all the materials direct to give their contractor to try to only make them charge them so much. And if they start doing that stuff, they're going to lose every sub they got.
I mean, we gotta.
It's not going to happen. It's ridiculous. Point, they don't want to pay it's weird. People it feels for like what they know.
Yeah, we got to. It's like we got to stand up. It's like, dude,
it's like there's a line in the sand at some point. Yeah. It's got to be.
And that goes for the plumber, the electrician, like absolutely. All the trade contractors out there. Yeah, there's a lot that goes into getting a license to do this. There's
lots of overhead that people don't even know about.
Yeah, there's tons of overhead to have a guy come out to put. I mean, in Atlanta, we were making, of course, this was, 10 years ago, but we were making profit was like $1,200 a house for two system house.
Yeah, it's not enough.
And we were putting in everything. Like, we were running everything.
Now, Taylor, do you guys still do like full duct system changeouts too, or are you just primarily equipment only?
We will. Not something I like to do, but we will. I'd say one in every 20 we do is a duct changeout. But it's
offering it and not what,
yeah.
If it needs offered, you offer it, right? Well,
yeah. I mean, I'm not going to go out there and try to sell somebody
that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And now if somebody goes out and people put a 12 inch piece of flex on a 4-ton unit, it's like, dude, I'm not putting a change out in this because I'm going to have issues. The static pressure is going to be 7 on the return. It's like I'm not putting a new unit in and having to deal right. with that and my problem. So at that point, then I would, price out, adding return here, doing whatever we need to do to make it correct.
Yeah.
But
now I will say, like, you two know how much I train, right? I train a lot all over two different states.
Yep.
That is becoming more popular, and I'm glad that I hear that. 4 years ago when I was training, it'd be 4 or 5 different companies in a room, and you didn't hear that too much. But now it's like, look, I can't put this on there. I'm going to have a ton of callbacks on this, and I won't be able to charge you because I just put it in.
Yep.
So, yeah, we got to, more and more contract, which will help everybody. That way, when you give a price on a half a duct system or a whole duct system, the other guy's doing the same in front of you or behind you at least. And it's not just you offering a duct system and the other two guys are like, nah, you don't need that. You're good. We'll just throw a system in there,
You'd be surprised.
It needs to be everybody.
It's the last 2 weeks since everybody was just so slow. I've went to multiple units from different companies around the Charlotte area that were actually unplugging stuff. And, it's going to, for instance, last week I had a lady call me in Charlotte. I don't do work in Charlotte. She called me, said, hey, so-and-so gave me your number. I'll pay you whatever you want to come out here and look at it because I know I can trust you to tell me what's wrong. And so talked to her on the phone. I said, well, how old is the unit? 8 years old. I said, is it registered? Do you have the warranty? Oh yeah, I got the warranty stuff. I said, so what did they say? It's going to be $7,000. I need to do all these different things. I said, ma'am, it's still under warranty. They're charging you $7,000 labor to change a warranty fan motor and a coil out. And so we went out there. They unplugged the contactor, the capacitor, and it was just sitting there. They left the low voltage on the contactor. So the only thing she could hear was going because it was pulled in the contactor.
Oh, yeah.
We the plugged it back buzzing. In. Yeah. The only thing that was wrong with it was the capacitor was bad. They pulled the little tip that sticks off the top of the capacitor, pulled it off, and it's like, that was the only thing that was wrong with it. And it was under warranty. It's like, what in the world, people?
Yeah, and see, that'll never go away, man. I don't think that'll ever go away.
Yeah, it's... I think that's why we've done good, is because I'm not... You might not want to hear what I'm going to tell you, but it's going to be the truth, and it's going to be, you know, I'm not going to feed you a line of bullshit. I'm going to tell you what's wrong with it, and if you don't want to listen to me, that's fine, but when you call me at midnight on a Saturday, I'm going to tell you that, you know, you're going to wait till Monday because you didn't listen the first time.
Yep.
You know?
And I think homeowners can sense that, right? I think, and Rhydon can speak on this, right, with sales, mm-hmm. and we have guys like my buddy Zach on here that sells in home. And if you, in your mind, right, I mean, if you truly believe something, you're like, hey, this is what it is. They can see that. They can sense that. And homeowners can see some bullshit, too, if it's piling up.
Yeah, they can.
And that's when they start making multiple calls, right? And I truly believe you go out there and you treat a homeowner properly and be honest with them, you've got them, right? You can...
Yeah.
It's going to add more business. You know, they're going to tell their friends. That's that kind of advertising stuff will never go away. That'll always be there.
But I try to think of it as my grandma. Somebody's coming to my grandma's house, and how would I want them to treat her? She has no
right.
I mean, you could make up whatever
right.
in God's name, and they're going to say, okay, well, when can you fix it? How much is it going to cost? That's the two questions they ask. Or when can you put a new one in? And it's like, you know, people are just going out there and telling homeowners a whole bunch of BS just to make some money because they're getting paid commission, which whether or not, you know, that's right or wrong, whatever, but it's kind of a kind
no,
of
there's a
that.
Sketchy line there, and everybody knows, you know, there's a lot of podcasts out there that talk about that, how to improve your profitability, how to improve it in, on the maintenance season. We've talked about it on this show.
Yep.
There's a lot of stuff people don't want to talk about. It's a sketchy line there, man. It really is. I've been stuck in the middle of it before where I was, you know, one of 40 techs, and it's a tough mental game to get pushed on you. It really is. I mean, if that's your bread and butter, it's tough. And so that kind of segues us into how has it been talking to homeowners about SEER 2 or new equipment? Have you had them ask you stuff you didn't think they would know? How's that been going? Because I know you do a lot of the quotes.
Yeah. 90% of homeowners have no clue what SEER rating is or SEER 2. So
right.
When they call me out, I explain it to them like, hey, I had bought some Rhydon equipment at the end of last year for one, a tax break, two, to help customers out this year so they didn't have to the price increase stuff that was going on.
Right.
So I was pricing 14 SEER and then 14.3 SEER 2. And I've had people, you know, what's the difference? Well, you know, I got to explain how they test it and all that. And most homeowners that I deal with, like, they ask me, what would I put in my house? And I give them, you know, this is variable speed. This is what that means. And this is two stage. This is what this means. And you can, you know, do you want to spend that much money? This is more comfort here. This is less comfort. This is going to make your lights dim every time it cuts on, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah. Still, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
A 14 SEER will still do that, obviously.
Yep. Yep. So, I mean, most of the customers that we're putting in for are doing two stage and variable speed. If somebody calls with a single wide, I'm not even going to mention a variable speed because I'm not going to, they're never going to benefit from that, first of all. And two, I don't want to go back out there and have to work on that because the neighbor's probably going to steal it and put it at his house and then it's going to get real awkward. So,
I mean, do you have more homeowners hitting you with noise or comfort or instead of? I mean, I know it depends on the call and the area, right? I mean, downtown Charlotte's not the same as, you know, Valdez and Morgan, where we're going, where I'm moving, kind of where you're at, obviously. But you still have those pockets. So if you go to a, you know, if you go to a nicer neighborhood, I mean, are you maybe a younger homeowner? Are they asking you about comfort, humidity, any of that?
Usually, no. They call me because it's hot and I come out there and it's, say, compressor's bad, whatever. Right. That's whenever I break into the conversation. What I usually price is like a base model 14 seer, then a two stage, then a variable speed. I say not a good, better, best, because, you know, quality wise, I feel like, you know, they're pretty much the same, whether it be a 14
or a piece of gear. It's just different technology.
Yeah. That's a good point. Exactly. Yeah. Good, better, best can be a little
misleading there. So I'd break it down into, you know, this thing's stupid quiet. You can't even hear it run. And this is what my customers' feedback from this unit were. This unit here, you're going to save $800 on, and it's going to be a step up from what you had, but it's not going to be as quiet as this system would be. And I give them, I actually call my customers a couple months later, ask them about their power bills, how they've liked it, any complaints they've had. And I've got, you know, like a list of that. So I can refer to a customer if they're like, well, I'm not sure about that unit. I'm like, well, I've got five people you can call here. You know, if you want to hear their feedback.
That's a good point.
I was going to say that right there, the amount of guys that actually do that. And now there comes a point when if your company gets to a size, you're not going to be able to personally be the guy that makes that phone call.
Yeah.
But making that phone call personally.
Sure. Chirp can do that for you.
Chirp can do that for you. Yes, it can. Slide that one in there. Boom. You know what else is good? I'll tell you what's good. Hummingbird Hell is from Red Oaks. Freaking great.
Y'all going to have to give me a brief intermission. I got to walk to the beer cooler, and it's going to take about 20 seconds.
All right. Elevator music coming in right now.
There you go.
This episode is brought to you by Red Oak. Fueled by... future new sponsor. Wouldn't that
they
be great?
They have to sponsor us now.
Ah, come on, Jake. Let's work some magic, buddy.
I'm excited about the tour, man.
I know. I'm pumped.
You know how many times I've driven by that?
I know. Trust me. And I'm going to be driving by it a hell of a lot more coming up than I was before.
So me and Ryan have to pick a Friday at 4:30 to go here. That's...
Who's picking you up? That's what I
want to
know.
I know, right?
A brew.
Can we bring a designated drunk driver?
Yeah.
That'll get you in trouble.
No joke.
Well, I wasn't able to pop it very well because it was kind of a rip-off.
It's a peel-off.
Peel-off. So
now that I think about it, I have not seen these bottle tops y'all are talking about.
Well, yeah, I just tore off my last one. It's pretty cool. It looks like a regular tab on the side, but you put your finger in and kind of peel it backwards like if you had a bottle opener in your hand, and it just rips the center out of it. And then you pull off the sides.
You're gonna
kind of weird.
God, send me a picture of that.
Yeah.
I wonder when have y'all seen the draft plastic cups that fill up from the bottom? I wonder if they're gonna make a comeback. Have you seen that?
Mm-mm.
Where they set them down on...
Oh, on the bar, like an actual
reverse,
bar.
Like reverse emulsion, yes. Is that what it is? And like emulsion?
It pours from the bottom.
Oh, no, I know what you're talking about.
The plastic cup has like a one-way valve in the bottom. It looks like a clear plastic cup you just get a draft beer in. But when they set it down on this... they'll devise it, just the beer fills up from the bottom. But I saw it like 20 years ago.
TikTok or something.
Yeah, I saw it 20 years ago at a Hooters when I went to the Masters, and we were in a big, you know, Hooters tent they had set up in the parking lot, and I'm like, would you look at this? It's pouring from the bottom. So it had like no problems, you know, foaming up or anything. It just filled up. And I mean, these were throwaway cups, so I don't know. I guess it didn't take off.
Probably too expensive. Everybody's like, I'll just pay half the price and drink my beer like a man.
Yeah, that could. Yeah. Oh, that's messed up, man. All right, so Ryan's a sales guy over here. I'm kind of sales guy too.
Don't you somewhat. Hate those?
Don't you hate sales guys?
I think Ryan's got like 50 questions for you on that.
We're not even there. Let's see.
We're not there. Okay.
Yeah, we're not there yet.
Well, no, let me. So let's.
So we went through, we talked about homeowner headaches with changes of CO2 and refrigerants. You know, you kind of also, that segues into changing types of equipment. And I know as we go up in SEER, you're continuing to see more and more companies turn to multi-stage and variable speed compressors. So, you know, 3 or 4 years ago when you got into this, you know, I'm assuming most of what you were even working on was base level single stage, you know, slamming that stuff in as quick as you could get it. And, you know, now you're saying when you go to a homeowner, you're talking about two stage, you're talking about variable speed. So in the last couple of years, the changes in equipment, and especially with the CO2 changes, how has that affected you? And what are your thoughts on kind of where the industry is going with that technology? I know you happen to install the two brands that Dennis and I have been the closest to, him a little bit closer to one more than me so far, but I'm getting there. But you know, how have those changes affected, you know, your thoughts on where the market's going and how you want to focus training your guys for what's even coming? And I know that kind of training thing's a further question, but you know, where's your head at on moving into more two stage, multi-stage and variable speed product now?
So even when I first started, I was still selling a bunch of the Rheem 16 sears.
Okay.
Two-stage at that point.
Gotcha.
So we're really familiar with the two-stage already because I think we probably sold the most at the Hickory Branch out of any contract. Well, I was told that in 2022. So we were pretty already on, you know, set for the two-stage stuff. So all my guys, you know, knows how it is, knows how to repair.
Which is now the base, right?
Which is now the base for the Rheem product, correct?
Yeah, and so they're already used to that. I did not even offer variable speed stuff until the last year because I was not the greatest fan of the communicating systems that Rudd offered, and I'm selling predominantly Rudd systems, Rudd, whatever you want to call it.
It's rude to say Rudd.
That's right.
Rude to say Rudd, so we'll say both. So, I mean, we were used to the two-stage stuff. Dennis introduced me to some of the variable speed, the non-communicating stuff. I wasn't a big fan of, like, the Greflex because it was one weighed, like, a freaking ton to get that thing in an attic. So
yeah, a little cumbersome.
Like, oh, man.
I mean, a little cumbersome on there. Yeah.
Hefty.
Yes. She ain't going nowhere when she's there, that's for sure. Yeah. But
that was the question.
Yeah. So recently, in the last, I don't know, how long have I been buying Bosch stuff? Eight months, something like that.
Yep.
I mean, we've put a lot of those in. I trained Dennis and Grayson come to the shop and done some training with us, got us up to speed. I'm one of those guys that I take the manuals home and read it and then send it home with my guys and say, don't call me with the stupid question. Because they say no question is stupid, but it's stupid if you didn't read the manual and you called me.
That's right.
So they took the manual home. You know, I emailed it to them. They read through it. They're good at installing it. They do clean work. And, you know, it's as long as you're not scared of the stuff in it because it's different. You know, I like the 24-volt side of the variable speed systems. So it's not as different on the guys installing it. So it doesn't freak them out as much. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the technology is trapped in that board, right? It's not it's not up to you trying to set a stat up, so to speak.
I had a contractor today that he's bought 3 or 4 systems. He's not put his hands on all of them until he really put his hands on one today. And I got 3 phone calls within a 2-hour period. I've never heard him so excited about a different new piece of equipment than I have since I started selling to him 7 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Now we try not to get into brand heavy on here, obviously, and we can take brand out of it. So I've talked to Taylor before about communicating systems, and you can take brand completely out of it. And mm-hmm. I'll never forget when he told me, he said, you know what? I finally, you know, the salesman said, look, you got to start selling some more high sear or offering it. Okay. So I put it in. It was high sear, you know, full inverter, communicating. You had to have, you know, four wire communicating stat. And it worked great until it decided to fart one day. Yep. And I go out there, reset power, and nothing's wrong. You know, what do you charge for that? You can't charge anything for that. Like, you put it in 6 months ago. There is nothing wrong. But between communication from the stat to the outdoor board to the indoor board, I don't care what engineer wants to come on this show. I don't think they probably listen to this show. But they want to come on this show. They still ain't got that figured out, man. They just ain't. No. I took tech support on those. I had those calls with software. And I'm on the phone with a guy for two hours, and we still don't know what's wrong with it. And it ends up being that the stat needed to be an older software or a newer software version. Like, I'm not cool with that. Like, we got to get away from that. It's yep. And then you take all that away, and what do you have? You got a compressor, a fan, a blower, a coil. Like, we haven't reinvented HVAC. We gotta dial that back a little bit, and let's make it where we can work on it. You know, I do love me some variable speed, right? But yeah.
It's like 1980s cars. They thought they started getting a little technology, and they put a bunch of crap on there that wasn't worth shit, basically. And then they, you know, it was terrible.
Worst year of the vehicle ever. Yeah.
It's the 80s. I mean, look at the Camaros.
Oh my God. Yeah. Worst Camaro.
I hope you guys don't drive the Camaros.
Yeah. Hope we don't have any IROC guys on here.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I bought an 86 Chevrolet work truck one time. It had a 305 in it. And I didn't think it was going to pull off to get out of the dealership, out of the parking lot. It's like, what is going on with this thing? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I know you're big on training. I think I'm seeing more and more of that nowadays with what's coming down the line. You about have to, right? Yeah. Even if it's simple, you got to get your guys in there.
And I feel like on the install side, not what I've done is in our software that we use for dispatching. So I've got a lead guy, and pretty much all my guys, if I send them out there to do it, they could do it by themselves, but I still got a lead guy, you know, that oversees that. But having checklists that they have to, you know, I remember it because I'm the one that's got my name on it, but
right,
it's not their name on it. So I just want to, they do great work, but I have checklists like, you know, whatever is the vacuum down to 400 microns, is the condenser pad level, is the surge protector on? Did you explain to the customer how to use the thermostat? Like, all kinds of checklists that's helped me out as far as install wise, and helped them out that they sign off at the bottom what they done, how much they had to add, refrigerant, how long the line set is, the subcooling, all those things that they download onto a file on every job. So that way they don't forget something, because it's easy to forget something when it's pouring down rain and not a great day and you got three tents out there, you know?
Now, I have to ask, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but part of your checklist system and everything else, is a lot of that attention to detail, did some of that come from having been in the military before you came out and you wanted, you know, it's a way of regimenting stuff, you know, over a period of time to kind of say, guys, this is how it needs to be done, this is what we should do, or did that come from your experience in working for other contractors, maybe it's something they did, or kind of where did that come from? Because I 100% agree with it. One of the things that I worked for years and years and years was trying to get guys to do job site startup sheets. You know, you always, I'm sure you heard it from your other sales guys and everyone else with your JSIS or your job site information sheets if you had warranty issues, but not as many companies years ago would actually do a true startup checklist. More do it now, but you know, how did you decide that was how you wanted to go, aside from keeping your guys in line.
Yeah, probably military had a lot to do with that. But my dad, he's very organized as well. So, and my grandpa. It's a long line of different entrepreneurs for different things. But I think the neat and cleanliness come from the military because I'm very OCD and my wife wants to kill me most of the time because, like, I show up at the house and there's one piece of dirt and I'm freaking sweeping the whole house. But I like to have everything professional. My customers are paying for professionals and I come out, not some right. jackleg that's got three teeth
that's right.
That knows how to throw an air handler underneath the house and, you know, throw some mastic on it, cover up the hole. You know, it's like they're paying quality. They're paying good money.
Well, they're paying a lot of guys. Money for this stuff. Yeah.
So I want them to know that they got the best experience from start to finish, from the time they call me and I'm talking to them to the guy that maybe I just hired 6 months ago leaves. They don't know if he's been there for 6 years or if he just started yesterday because the way they handle right. themselves and, you know, yep. they're wearing a uniform. We all wear uniforms. My trucks are clean because, one, I'm OCD, and two, I want the customer to know that we're a professional business. We take it serious, and we want to make sure we're taking care of them. And they feel comfortable letting us do that.
Well, and I don't know how many times I've said that on this show about don't be the guy that pulls up and opens your door, and the homeowner's looking. I mean, they're looking. Oh, and yeah. three Mountain Dew bottles fall out, and you get out, and you got to try to tuck your shirt in, and you know, drag your ass up to the door, and then you're mad that the guy in front of you got the job, but he was $7,000 higher.
Yeah.
And you're like, well, how did he get the job? Well, you know.
Yep.
There's a whole lot more behind that. you know, when we walked up to a house, you know, when I had the only wrapped vehicle in Atlanta, and the lady's like, oh, I see you all over town. And we looked big when we showed up, you know, just like you. You know, when Taylor shows up in his trucks, he looks big. You know, I've seen Taylor's trucks and the way, you know, carries himself, show up in a town like Charlotte, you could charge and be right there with everybody else and yep. behind him. And the homeowner still feels comfortable. Like, you got to look professional. I mean, you hit the nail on the head there. Yeah. And yeah, they are paying a ton of money for this. I say this in training all the time. I'm like, guys, you know, take a little pride, change the line set insulation. For crying out loud, you know, use some new duct tape. Or, well, you know, I don't want to go too far, but
yeah,
no, yeah, I mean, take a little pride.
You wouldn't be surprised, but it's like you're not comparing. And I tell customers this all the time, like, look, you know, if you don't pick me, that's fine. I understand. Because usually people that call just wanting quotes are going to pick the cheapest person just because that's what their intent is, to get the cheapest thing. And, you know, once you kind of explain it to them, it's like, look, you know, we're all buying the same equipment, pretty much the same price. If you got this dude that's $4,000 cheaper, some corners are being cut there. There's no, you know, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. So you might just, you know, whoever you get the best feel right. with, you know, you need to go with, whether it be me or another company. And, you know, 80% of the time they choose me, but if they're wanting the cheapest guy, they're going to choose my neighbor. So, you know, it is... It's just part of the game, I guess. But you get what you pay for a lot of times. Not always, but in our sense,
Do you do a yard sign? Is that a thing anymore?
Yeah we actually get a lot of calls off yard signs. Cause,
okay. I was going to say, always thought that was a good idea, man. The old yard sign.
Yep. We see your signs around everywhere.
I know. I'm laughing because of the yard sign story from Monday. Does Dennis know this story?
Which one?
Yeah, apparently not.
The one where you put the yard sign through the neighbor's pipe.
Well,
puncture that with a yard sign?
You're talking about the one where I took out the gas line? Building my duplex?
Yeah, talking about the gas line that was 3 inches, buried 3 inches underground.
Yeah. Yeah. Not a good time. I was telling you about the guy too that I had built a duplex, and that was the yard signs actually work. I mean, and you get co-op on them, so I buy every yard that we put in, that's part of the checklist, is a yard sign, unless it's, you know, somewhere that I don't want their neighbors calling me, you know.
Right.
You know what I mean.
Put your competitor's yard sign up.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, I'm going to ask you if there's something on that checklist. So I know you come up with it. Is remove the cardboard from the condensate pump on there?
Yeah. Well, no, it isn't, but I've stopped buying those condensate pumps.
Is it only one brand that puts the cardboard? Is it just Little Giant?
Yeah. Or? And the white top ones, it's like, oh, man, that's a headache.
Not Little Giant. Or is it Little Giant? Yeah.
I just want to know.
Cardboard in. So Diversitech doesn't do the cardboard.
I just want to know the brand of condensate pump that's running on that unit up in Valdez. I mean, if that thing is still, what brand is that thing? That should be the condensate pump brand you buy for life.
I'm going to have to look
put
it
in
up.
One.
Yeah.
And it runs forever.
It's got like a 2-horse motor on it.
Your light's dim when it cuts on too.
Yeah.
That's it.
It's got to have its own 20 amp service.
Dedicated circuit to it.
That's right. Yeah, we were doing a training in Valdez, and I kept emptying this like 2-quart thing while we were doing training, and I finally just went and cut the condensate pump off one of the systems down there, and I plugged it in, and of course all the guts are showing. You can see the little fan blade turning, the motor cranking, and it still works. I threw some line on there.
I had it was probably 2 years ago. My uncle, he was in the Air Force, old school guy, and we changed the unit out for him. His condensate pump had been through 2 units, and it's still the same one. He said, "You going to change the pump?" I said, "Yeah, I always change the pump." He said, "Don't." I'm like,
"Don't."
What do you mean? I was like, "That thing looks like hell." Like that thing. He's like, "It's been here for 40 years." I'm like, "Well,
oh no, okay. It's a story now. We just got to see how long."
Yeah. Well, he sold the house with it, so. I mean, apparently, she's still kicking, I reckon.
Well, I used to get calls from homeowners. They're like, you know, I go out back, and they're like, "Yeah, this is the one that's freezing up here." And they're like, "This is the newer one. This one over here is, you know, literally 1979, and this one's an 08. And I'm like, "Yeah, well."
Yep.
You know, this one literally at this point is never going to leak. It's not. It's just not going to leak.
You know, there's 3-inch thick copper on those coils.
It's,
I mean,
just
it
different.
Wears out.
It's different copper. Yeah. Nobody said it was efficient. You know, nobody said it does great removing humidity. It's not comfortable. But it is not going to leak refrigerant.
But it was more comfortable than no AC in 1979. I'll tell you that.
Well, then they're like, so this new one that you're replacing this one with, like, is it going to leak? Well, you know,
it's got a 10-year warranty.
It's got a 10-year warranty. That's all I want to say. I'm not going to say it's not going to leak, but I think copper is one thing, but I think these new aluminum coils coming down the line now, not just like I said, not brand specific, but I think they're all doing a pretty good job that I know of. Copper coils with other brands are still having some problems, man.
Everybody's gone to. Outside, well, I guess exterior coils, but most everybody's gone aluminum inside, and you're seeing more and more flip to microchannel outside again, which is interesting because microchannel, it was a thing in like the 80s, kind of like the weird cars, but microchannel had its run before, and now it's circling back through everything.
I mean, it does great doing what it needs to do, and it holds a lot less refrigerant.
Like those old trains with 2 compressors holds 19 pounds of Freon.
Yep.
Oh, man. I've worked on the two stage train with the 2 compressors. There was a whole bunch of shit going on.
Didn't the old Ream, like UASLs had dual twin compressors, I think, too, back in the day.
Yeah, so that wasn't very cost effective.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's... I've went out to a couple around here, and I know who they are now, and I don't send my guys to them because they call them, "What the crap is this thing? It's got 2-3-phase contactors on it and all this other stuff." I'm like, "I forgot. I'll be out there in a minute." So it's too much going on there. You know, they don't ever see that. They're like, why does this thing got three, you know, two contactors on with three phase looking contactors? So like, dude, just head on to the next one. I'll be there. I'm not even spending 2 hours explaining it.
That train, I don't know what model it was, not to beat train up, but that one train with the two stage, I would come up on it in Atlanta a lot. It was a lot of wiring for what it needed to do, right? It didn't really have a whole lot it needed to do.
But by God, they lasted forever. I mean, I'm still working on some of them.
Yeah. I mean, when we get a Y2 call, can't we just turn this other one on? I mean, that's all we got to do. Why is there so much going on here? All right, so let's. I know Ryden's got some stuff here.
Oh, I do. I feel like I'm cheating, but I'm going to ask him anyway.
Yeah, on the sales side, which it's kind of good knowledge. I mean, you just give us your straight up, you know, straight up opinion on some of this because we do have a lot of guys that listen to this show that are smaller.
Well, and we talk about it, you know, we have a different perspective than most of the other shows that are in our industry. You know, we're looking at it from distribution and now manufacturer's rep side. So, you know, we're going to ask different questions than contractor to contractor or business owner to business owner in some ways. Because at the end of the day, the only way I can be a better salesperson or the only way any other sales rep listening to this show can be a better salesperson is someone's got to ask these kinds of questions. And if you're not willing to ask these same questions to the guys that you're calling on every single day, just like I'm about to ask Taylor, you're not doing yourself or your contractors, you know, the proper service. So, you know, I grew up in a heating and air business. My dad was a contractor. I was lucky enough that we had a couple of sales guys that were very, very good that I hope to emulate, you know, over time because of things they taught me. But trust me, we had plenty of them that were freaking terrible. And a lot of the times it was because they didn't ask the questions. You didn't feel like they cared about who you were as a person, let alone as a customer. So, you know, as we get into a world now that is so fast paced, the things that contractors, I assume, and, you know, look for is a little bit different than they did before. But, you know, especially Taylor is a much younger contractor in a lot of cases that's moving into this. You know, what are you looking for in a vendor partner and how do you make those, some of those determinations as you start to grow and as you want to set up your business for different levels of success? You know, what do you look for, you know, initially? You know, are you looking at incentives or are you looking at relationship?
Yeah, I would definitely say the support behind, you know, their equipment, whether or not, I mean, they could sell me the biggest turd in the world, but if they stand behind it and if I have an issue and they take care of it, that's who I'm calling, you know, and that's who I'm going to push their product because I know when a customer calls me, you know, says, hey, man, you just put a new unit in and it's not working, say that we had this a couple of years ago, compressors were bad from the factory, and, you know, the distributor that I was using sent me a new unit, and no questions asked, you know, we put it in, it was a done deal. So that makes a big difference to me as a contractor because I don't have to put up with all the BS, filling out paperwork, and what did they do here, and why did you do this? You know, they know I do it right, because they know who I am and they didn't ask questions. They sent me a unit. I put the unit in, customer's happy. I'm happy. You know, everybody wins. So as far as that goes, as long as somebody stand behind what they're selling to me, because they're making their cut out of it. So they need to, you know, help me out if there is an issue. So that's what I'm looking at most of the time is if they're going to stand behind it whenever shit hits the fan.
Yep, it's always it's that brand versus, and we hear that, it's brand versus distributor support. Once again, most everybody's building a pretty solid piece of equipment. And we had just, when we were doing this fan favorite countdown, our episode with HVAC God with Keith, I had posted a clip a couple of weeks, or maybe last week, early last week for him. And he said the exact same thing. He said, you know, if you're going to go through this whole rigmarole if I have a DOA unit on site and we've got to go through this, 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 and this, as opposed to you're just going to come, you're going to take care of it, and then we're going to sort it out after we get this problem fixed. He said, you know, you're my guy. If you're going to take care of me when I'm in a pinch, that's how I know who I'm going to rely on moving forward. He said, don't send me through all this, but we all know that we've got to deal with the level of paperwork that's going to happen because we're doing this to solve the problem. But don't stand in the way of us solve the problem. Let's get it fixed, and then we'll fix it on our end too.
Exactly. And I've been on the other side of that where I've made a phone call on a brand new piece of equipment, and they brought me the part. You know, appreciate that. Then they brought me that part, and then literally three parts of that unit were bad in a brand new unit. The blower housing was not even put together. The expansion valve where they put the little thread on to the coil itself, from the factory had cross-threaded. That was one of the issues. They had to bring a whole new coil out. Then on the new coil, the expansion valve was bad, and the blower wheel wasn't put together. And I was doing a job for the county, and they had to have it the next day. That was one of my first jobs for the county. So they come out there, brought me all the stuff. Not to say I was not ticked off that three parts were bad on a new unit already, and they didn't have any other units in stock at that time because it was during COVID. So,
fun times.
But it took like 5 months to get my money back. And I'm calling them like, hey, man, I'm pretty straightforward. I'm going to tell you what I think. So I'm like, hey man, you know, I'm still charged for this. But, oh, just pay it. We'll reimburse you. I'm like, okay, whatever. 5 months later, it's still not, you know, reimbursed. And I keep calling them like, hey man, they're like, well, what you need to do is just call up here and be a real, you know, asshole basically and raise some cane. I'm like, dude,
that's not cool.
That's what I'm doing right doing now.
Yeah. I'm not the person I used to work for. I'm not going to raise cane. That's not going to solve anything. I need it fixed, and tell me when you're going to fix it, and that's all I need to know. You know, I'm not going to call up there and look like a douchebag.
Right.
I just want it fixed, and that's as simple as that. And since then, another thing happened after that. It was 4 months before I got a refund on it, and I'm like, look, I'm not going to push the project. If they're not going to stand behind me, I'm not going to freaking help them out. So that's kind of how it –
yeah, because these homeowners, man, these new homeowners will chew you up and spit you out now.
Yeah, they will.
Unfortunately, they are different. They squeaky wheel gets the grease. You know, when I get involved and the homeowners to that point, when I go out there, I've dealt with homeowners for a long time. Even before HVAC, I was dealing with them when I was a general contractor and remodeler. They are not the same they used to be, and your business is on the line. I mean,
your business is on the line. 2 seconds.
Oh yeah. Between Google and Facebook and stuff, like, you're just done. I mean, you can't afford that. You just can't afford it. So it puts you in a spot, and yeah, I think you're right. I think it comes down to support. You know, most distributors are starting to see that that's a big deal. And hopefully everybody tries to get on board with that. I used to always say, you know, it was really big in mini splits, right? Everybody's like, you know, what's your favorite mini split? And I'm like, well, I'm going to put a mini split in that I can get a part for, has a decent warranty, and somebody that can pick up the phone and help me work on it.
Yeah.
If I got those three, I don't care if it's called, you know, whatever. It don't matter. Like, I gotta, because there's mini splits online, right, that come from factory to your shop, and they don't have a distributor, right? They don't have a rep. They don't have nothing in the middle. They also don't have a parts place. It's from the manufacturer to your house, right? You try to find a part on something like that, it don't exist. There is no parts. It's just a throwaway, you know?
So you're telling me if I buy it on Amazon, you're going to put it in, right?
Yeah. I was going to throw, Amazon a plug there.
I don't understand why y'all don't put it in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Pioneer. I mean, I've said it on here before. You know, Pioneer is one of those. Now, it might last you 10 years, right? You install it, it might work out great. But when it breaks, you can't get parts for it.
Nope, and you don't know how to fix it.
No.
Well, even if you did, like, you don't have anywhere to take the part to.
Yep.
To warranty it or any of that, right? That's where all that middleman comes in. And you got to have it. It's just what it is. That's kind of where we come in at Keystone, right? We're in between the distributor and the manufacturer, as far as, you know.
We all have to have someone to bitch at.
Yep.
Oh yeah. Yeah, we are. We are straight up caught up in the middle for sure.
Yep.
All right. So before we get into a little bit of what your pretty hardcore hobby is, you got any crazy critter stories you've had recently?
See, recently, I sit in the office all the time, so it kind of sucks. I don't get the fun anymore. You know, every day I was coming home with some
cool stories.
Well, not
recently. Cool. What's your worst one?
Yeah. I can't. See, I should have wrote down everything that has happened to me, because they're for when I worked for the other company, it was a different clientele, I should say, that I was working with. So every day it was something. And some of the things I probably shouldn't say on here, so but there was a customer of mine, it's probably 2 years ago, and a guy works for him named Chase. We called him Chad. Customer calls, like, "Hey man, I got a trailer," and this dude's got more money than he knows what to do with. He's got like 60 some rental houses. And he said, "Hey man, I got a trailer down here, and I need you to go look at the ductwork." I said, as far as the ductwork goes on a trailer, they ain't really much you can look at.
No, I can't look at it. It's under plastic.
Yeah. He said, "Well, you got a camera?" I said, "Well, why do you need it?" He said, "Well, there's a damn possum in that thing, and we can't find it." I said, "What?" He said, "There's a possum in there, and the homeowner said it come out of the vent and looked at him and went back in the vent."
Oh, my God. Well, at least he went back in there.
Yeah, of course it did. So I said, "Oh my God." I'm like, "Okay." So me and Tyler and what we call Chad, his name's Chase, went out there. Well, Chase just started with us like 2 weeks before that. And so we show up this trailer because I wanted to take everybody to see what in the world this even was. At that point, that was all I had anyways. Right. So we go in there and we go to the master bedroom, and this, you know, the little trash grabbers that people pick up trash on the side road. Yep. They had that and a trash can sitting beside the register. And so I'm like, what? Yeah. And so we walk in there. I'm like, "Well, boys,
this ain't animal control."
Yeah. I'm like, "I don't really know what to tell you, but you stick your head and the flashlight down this hole, because you know it's just one run. I mean, it just goes 60 right. feet in one direction. And I'll stick my head in this one. We'll see if there's something in the middle." So I'd stick my phone down in there, and they're shining lights. I'm like, "Man, we can't find this thing." Like, "I don't know." Well, we call the guy. I'm like, "Man, we don't find we don't see a possum in here. I don't know where he's at. He might be in the, kitchen sink or something eating Cheetos, but he's not underneath the ductwork." And so he said, "Well, can you check underneath it?" I'm like, "All right, whatever." So I said, "Chad, get your ass underneath there." So we gave him a duck knife and that little grabber. And I got a picture on my phone. I had to send it to you. And he's like, "Why do I got to go underneath there?" I said, "Dude, you're the lowest on the totem pole, man." I said, "You're getting underneath that." And so he crawls underneath the house. He's like, "Man, it stinks under here." I said, "Well, you might be getting close." Long story short, we didn't wrangle the possum, but Chad was pissed. He's like, "I'm never going underneath the house." We shut the door on him, like, "You're stuck under there now." But he,
possum is so menacing, man. When I've came in contact with him in the crawl space,
I've had plenty of animal
that and, face, you know, encounters. Possums are.
I had my buddy hit me with a possum one day, literally smacked one. We're saying coyotes. Yeah, that's what I said. So I was in high school and we had a bunch of coyotes, and he had bought a coyote trap, and I worked at a taxidermist, and my preacher was actually a taxidermist as well on the side. So anyways, worked for him while I got off at Ace Hardware. I went and worked for that dude, two jobs. And So I would throw all the rotten meat in a like a cage. Well, a couple of days later, if I couldn't go there to look check the cage, Jacob would. And because the reason we had to check it is because we caught the neighbor's dog and forgot about it for 3 days, and they were putting stuff on Facebook looking for their dog, and it was in our damn kennel. So Jacob's up there. He's like, "We got something." I'm like, "All right, well, okay." So I come over there, and he's standing there kind of awkward. Like, I'm like, "What? What'd you catch?" He said, "It's over there." So I looked over beside the truck. About that time, I get hit in the back with something. Like, what in the world is that? And it was the possum. He threw the possum at me and hit me in the back with the possum. I'm like, Jesus Christ. Like, come on, man.
Was it alive?
Yeah. Oh, I mean, it was nice. Pretend like it was dead because Jacob was holding it by its tail.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I forgot. Yeah, they just died right there.
So, yeah, after that, I'm like, dude, we caught zero coyotes. We caught a couple hawks, the neighbor's dog, a lot of possums, and had pictures of tons of coyotes, but they were too smart for us. So we said,
I was going to say, they're a little bit probably too smart for that.
Yeah.
You ain't gonna catch a fox.
I don't know many people
that's
got smacked by a possum before, but I can say I have been smacked by a possum. Yeah. So.
All right. So we got to get into. I feel like we should have started with this. I'm gonna cue the Top Gun music now. So let's tell us a little bit about your little hobby you got flying planes around.
Yeah. So. I've always wanted to do it, and actually on my, you know what, that's kind of funny that you said Top Gun because my wife makes fun of me. I want to do it forever. Well, when we got married in Montana at Glacier National Park, and one of the national parks had a movie that you could go into and it was Top Gun. And I watched that movie, and I was like, Hannah, yeah, I've been wanting to get my pops. I said, I'm going to sign up for classes when we get back. And she's like, shut the hell up. No, you're not. Whatever. Well, okay. So that next week, I called up to Lincoln's Airport, which is the small town I'm at. I'm like, y'all got any classes for, you know, flying airplanes? Like, oh, yeah, yeah. So they hooked me up with a dude named Vladimir. And They said, I'll have him call you. I'm like, okay. They said his name's Vlad, but I wrote down on the paper, Flad. I thought his name was Flad. I'm like, who the hell's name's Flad? I'm like, whatever. So he calls me, some Russian dude calls me. He's Vladimir. I'm like, who? I'm like, this is Tailored Air. And he's like, yes, this is Vladimir calling about whatever air company. Anyways, so I'm like, oh yeah. He said, well, you want to come in and, you know, fly with us? I'm like, sure. So we went and flew, and I was like, this is fun. That's, you know, I'm going to do this. He said, well, most people don't make it through it. That's what everybody says. I'm like, whatever. So me and him actually become really good friends, and he's got two planes, and I was renting a plane out of Lincoln Airport, and so flew with him. I started in October range, right after September, actually November of last year,
okay.
And just finished up my private license, so now I can fly my wife around legally, and my friends, they basically just want to fly over the lake and go see their house, but... That's pretty much it.
There's my house.
He's like, let's go to the lake. All right, where else you want? I'm gonna call my grandma. She's gonna come outside and wave at us. Okay, hey granny, we're outside, look at us. Can you? Yeah, so that's pretty much what I get done. But
I mean, what's your plans on that? Are you gonna
do you have your own plane yet or
no? Not yet. I've looked at four, actually test flown a few, but I've got a little side business doing real estate stuff. So I got some rental property and do some flip houses and such. So I end up starting a spec house and bought a trailer park and some more property. So
I thought you didn't funds, do new construction.
No.
Well, I don't.
If it's actually, on wheels, I got it. Yeah.
Well, it's kind of hard not to with the, you know, the housing market right now is crazy. So trying to take advantage of it when I can, you know, I'm trying to retire now, when I'm 35. So
you kind of told it. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'm ready. Oh, I missed it. Damn. I'm going to pick a different number.
That's right.
So tell me, you were telling me the other day about the plane you were in and you were trying to take off and it was dark and you couldn't see anything. Or you were, maybe yeah. You were riding with a guy or you were.
Nah, we were flying. I was flying. I can fly at night, but I just, one, haven't flown enough at night to be like, yeah, I'm going to go here that I don't know what this airport. And I mean, it's just a different feel, you know, it's kind of hard to explain, but you can't tell if a light that you're looking at is either 20 feet in front of you or 600 yards in front of you or 4 miles away. It's hard to tell the difference at night when you're
until it hits your windshield.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, exactly. So that's kind of, and if you're, you know, 10,000 feet, you can tell because there's nothing 10,000 feet in the air you're going to smack besides another plane. But when you're 3,000 feet, everything is on like the horizon. So it's kind of hard to tell if you're about to hit a tower in front of you or if you're at Charlotte, you're seeing 40 miles away. You know, it's kind of, it messes with your head a little bit. But
is that like your standard cruising height for what you're flying is around 3,000 feet or?
Yeah. So it's, if I'm around LinkedIn just flying, you know, my wife or my dad or friends or whatever, I'll usually do 3,000 foot above sea level, which is about 2,000 feet above ground level where I'm at. So, you know, it changes if you're flying from my airport to, you know, the coast. If you're at 3,000 feet on your altimeter, which is, you know, it's telling you you're 3,000 feet, you're 3,000 feet above the ground out there, but you're 2,000 feet above the ground here because, you know, elevation change. So you just really got to pay attention there. But, you know, whenever I was 15, I brought a crotch rocket and my mom was all behind it. She's like, yeah, you saved money on gas. I'm like, that's exactly what I'm doing. I'm just saving money on gas. It's like, I don't understand what her reason was behind that, but I'm just kind of, I like a thrill, you know, you only live once. So
that's might true.
As well have fun.
Yep.
You're just here for a good time, right?
I am here for a good time. And that's what I actually bought, there's like online courses stuff that you have to do book work and then you got to do a practical exam and then you got to go for a oral exam. So you sit there and talk to an old dude that's flown for 50 years and he asks you questions and you answer them for a couple hours.
Jeez.
So it actually wasn't bad because I overstudied, not overstudied, but I studied so much it was not hard, but I was nervous going into it that, my God, it's 3 hours of him asking me questions. What in the world is he going to ask? But
yep, know that feeling.
It was fun. I mean, it's just a little hobby, and I plan on going to get my commercial rating just so I can fly myself when I buy a plane out west to vacation. And
I was going to say, I figured you're going to utilize this to
keep taking them off the bucket list.
Exactly, and whenever you can. It's just convenient. It's definitely not cheaper, by God, to fly your own plane somewhere, but it's more convenient. You know, you can go, I can drive 20 minutes, get on a plane and fly to the beach in an hour and then fly back, go eat lunch, come back and be back by, you know, 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's a whole different animal there.
Yep.
Yeah.
So that's pretty sweet. What's the furthest you've went, or is there a limit on that?
I can go wherever. I can fly anywhere I want to go. It's just got to be in VFR, which is visual flight rules. Since I don't have an instrument rating, I just have a private pilot rating.
Yep.
Then I can fly when there's certain visibility, certain cloud cover, that sort of thing. So if it's super cloudy, you can't see, I'm not getting up in the air because I'm not
instrument You don't have the instrumentation. Rated. Right.
Yeah, I've got instruments, but I'm not rated for that, so I can't technically fly in those conditions.
I just picture you like tapping on yours and trying to get the needle to move.
Yeah. Yeah, actually,
like a set of yellow jacket gauges.
Yeah. Well, so me and the instructor, so he's Russian, like I said, and I'm a redneck, as you can tell. So, you know, he's telling me something. And it's kind of a language barrier a little bit because he was from Russia. He was born in Russia. So he's telling me something, and it's nothing close to what I say. So we're sitting here looking at each other like, I don't know what you're saying, dude. And so for the longest time, when I first started, he was saying full reach. And I'm like, what is he talking, full reach? So I was grabbing it and pulling it forward towards me. He was saying full rich, which is the opposite of pulling it towards you. Pulling it towards you cuts the fuel supply. So I was grabbing it, and he was saying full reach. So I was grabbing it like full reach, maybe, you know, grabbing the pull. And so I'm pulling it. He's like, what the hell are you doing? I'm like, full reach. He's like, no, I said full reach. I said, that's what I said. He's like, then I'm looking at the checklist. I'm like, about four times, you know, four flights into it, I'm like, what is he talking about? Full reach. And I looked into him like, it's full rich. Okay, that makes more sense. So it was just, it was funny because he's kind of a redneck Russian and I'm a redneck American. So it worked out good and we're really good friends now, but there was definitely a time learning with him because it was hard to communicate. Then you hear air traffic control talking and you got the Russian dude and the redneck on the intercom talking to air traffic control. So they're confused as well, but it all worked out. Jeez. Yeah.
Well, cool. What is your, and I know we all got to get up and get to work tomorrow. I don't even know what time it is. Oh, it's not too bad. You got a DD coming to pick you up, don't you?
Nah, well, I started drinking water earlier, so.
Your wife's probably like,
nah. We'll bleep that part out.
Yeah. I'm hydrating. Yep.
He's just sleeping at the shop. He's going to sleep back there
on that cozy little couch over there.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not too bad. It's got a little pillows in the back, just in case my wife kicks me out.
Of course. You know she had to put throw pillows on that thing since she designed it.
That's right.
For the aesthetics of your office, honey.
That's right. I just had them in the back.
Now, I don't know if I've asked you this. I may have before, but what is your plans on your company? Are you wanting to grow a little bit, or you like where it's at? Are you seeing
see
yourself getting a little bigger?
Eventually, as of right now, I'm trying to keep the guys I got because they're all trained. They know what they're doing and grow our clientele more to keep those guys busier and really pay them well instead of spreading it thin between a lot of guys. I'd rather pay my guys really good salaries and keep them for 20 years versus having more work, more guys, you know. That's my take on it. I'm sure you could make more money if you did that eventually. But where we're at now with our profit margins and I don't have to babysit anybody. I don't.
No, there's a lot. There's no price for that.
No, there's not. Yeah.
I mean, they show up. The dudes that work for me are 19, 21, 23, 57, and 28. So,
oh, you got a group. You got a nice group there.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, it's the dudes are, I tell them to be there around, you know, 7:45. They show up at 7 o'clock in the morning. I mean, I'm in the bed half the time and it's like, ding, Jesus showed up. Ding, Chase is there. I'm like, well, they're ready to work. I mean, they show up. I want to be the guy that I never had as a boss that.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
My boss before never. Don't mean this, you know, it's true. Didn't give two craps about you. They didn't give a crap about your family. They didn't give a crap if you had enough money to eat at that, you know. I was never starving to death, but there's people out there that are. And I want to be the boss that people come into work and they're like, I'm ready to go. You know, if I need something, I know he's here for me. If, you know, if something's going on with the family, I'm not going to tell them you pick between your family or your job or anything like that. I want to make sure that they're taken care of, unlike I was, you know, I was not.
Everybody will take care of everybody. Yeah, that's if you can create that culture in your workplace, that's a lot.
Yeah. And I mean, so far, I'm sure there's people that pay some more than I do in the area. You know, as a small business, it's hard to offer health insurance. So that's, I mean, I've talked to different companies and, you know, yeah, they offer health insurance, but it's like, you still got to pay $500 a month. And when you go to the doctor, you're still paying out the pocket. You know, it's really not.
Yeah, it ain't because you don't want to offer it, right?
Yeah, it's not that I want to offer it.
Yeah.
No. And we offer retirement plans. And I mean, I give my guys, if we're slow that week, I'll give them hours just because I don't want them to, one, I don't want them to go looking somewhere else because they're good guys. So I'd like to pay them really well that they're not even thinking about going anywhere else because they know that they can't get it better than where they've got. And
right,
they're good at their job. So that's what I'd like to keep and not have to go look for work. Work comes to us and we're picking and choosing what we want to do versus picking everything just to keep the guys busy.
Well, and that happens because those guys are happy where they are. They're compensated well, so they do good work, which there in turn leads to you getting more work because they've done good work.
Exactly.
And well, and they always say that when people leave jobs, a lot of times it's not for money.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's a mental game, right?
Yeah.
It's something to do with their mental game. You got to keep them trusting you. You got to keep them excited about coming to work. Like you said, when they, if they're getting there 45 minutes early, that's huge. That's big, especially that age. Not to beat that age up, but.
And none of the people come into me every day. They're like, yeah, it's hard to find good help. I'm like, not if you treat them right and you teach them. All my guys didn't know what a heat pump was and they started for me, except for one. And I trained them the right way to do it instead of the quick way to do it. And that's why we don't have warranty issues. I mean, the guys, it might take them 2 hours longer to put it in than a lot of other companies, but when they walk away from it, they know they've done everything manufactured specs, that it's gonna, if it breaks, it sure as heck wasn't from anything we done.
Right.
And I can stand behind that 100% knowing that they done it and I done everything to make it correct. And if it fails, it just, it failed. It wasn't us.
Yeah, I remember when I did training over there, the first time I trained at your shop you got now, those guys were just like all ears, just staring at me like, let's go. Yeah. And you know, you don't get that. You don't get that a lot. And that's that culture you're creating, right? I mean, that's what it is.
That's what we're trying anyway. So far it's worked. And I had he's a good friend of mine. Now he had worked for me. He was my first employee, good guy. Actually talked to him today. But he got an offer from somebody else. So it was $2 more an hour. And I said, well, you know, grass ain't green on another side, brother. I said, but you know, you do what you need to do for your family. And if that's what you need to do, then, you know, that's up to you. Went and worked for him for 3 days, called me back. Hey man, got my job back. It's like, sorry, man. And you know, great guy. He's a good dude. And I was training him. But he realized that he screwed up real quick. You know, it's like, it ain't all, they might offer you something, but it ain't always what it's cut out to be. So, I just try to look in their shoes as, you know, that's what's helped me out a lot. Because like I said, I've had some really crappy leadership, army, you know, and previous job history. And I just don't want to be that guy. So that's kind of what drives me to do better and actually appreciate somebody versus just seeing them as, that's my, you know, dude just to make me money.
Right.
Well, we talk about that on the show all the time too. It's leadership and culture is what builds you a better business moving forward. And the more you care about your people and the more you serve the people that work for you, the more successful you are.
Yeah.
You give good to them and let them give good to the world, then you're in a good place.
And try to at least train your employees as well, because my brother-in-law worked for a company. He saw that I done HVAC and was like, hey, I'm going to do HVAC. So he didn't live near me. He went and worked for a company and went from not knowing what a capacitor was to going out and supposed to be fixing units in a 3-week span. They didn't train him. Jeez. They didn't. And so you imagine, one, it makes him, it kind of belittles him because he don't know what he's doing. It's not his fault. I would never send a dude out there by himself 3 weeks into it to go fix somebody's problem. And then you get a bad rep for your company because you got a dude coming out there that has no clue what he's doing, but it's not his fault. It's the company just pushing, trying to make more money. It's like, it's not a good product at the end of the day.
Yeah, that learning, you know, when it comes to trying to be in, being professional for a homeowner and showing up as a professional, like that sink or swim thing, that's how I was. I was thrown into a van. Like, you just got to go figure it out. It's like, holy moly. Mm-hmm. There's a lot going on walking up to a homeowner's house. Don't know what's going on. You don't know how to fix it. Then they're staring you down. You know, you have to be eased into that.
Yeah.
You know, school don't teach that.
And, you know, so, he was calling me, asking me questions. I'm like, dude, I mean, have you checked this? And he's like, what is that? And I'm like, oh God. Like, I don't know how to explain this over the phone. And he's a really smart guy. He picked up on it way quicker than 99% of people. He's super smart.
Right.
But it wasn't his fault. The company didn't want to put their time into training somebody. And that's, I mean, if he wasn't as smart as he was, he wouldn't have figured out even a quarter of what he did, you know?
Right.
So it's, I guess that's just the way it was. A really big company, so I guess that's maybe how they roll, but that's not how I want to roll.
I mean, some do, some don't, you know. I know big companies have a lot of times, they have a lot of turnover.
Yeah.
And that may be part of that, you know. I know a lot of guys that have gotten to your size and they're still at your size and they like it.
Yeah.
Some have eased on to be a little bigger and they still have that same mentality and they treat it the same. They just got, you know, five more guys that are still doing the same thing. But, you know, at some point you do have to step even further away as an owner and start working on you know, parts of the business now that didn't really exist and now they do. And it kind of sucks that you're not involved day to day on certain things, but I don't know. I talked to a lot of guys that are 4-man operations and they're just having a ball and they like it.
Yeah.
You know, and you can still sell that. You can still sell that down the road. I mean,
yeah. Especially if you're just doing change outs and stuff like that and service contracts, that's what, you know, they want to see, not a whole bunch of new construction, I wouldn't think, but,
yeah.
You know, if you only got 4 guys, which that's pretty, we only got 5 plus me. So we don't really have to go out looking for it. So it's kind of nice. Where you don't have to super advertise for it because you don't have 55 guys sitting there looking at you when they come in. And
right.
I told my guys, I'm like, look, I'm never going to send you home without a paycheck. So if you guys want to work, it might not be HVAC, but we'll work on one of my rental property or we'll do something during the slower times just to make sure that you can provide for your family, because I'm not going to tell them to go home with no pay just because nobody called that day. It's like, that's not fair to them whenever it's busy and I'm making money. And
right.
My dad did the same thing, man. Still does. Still does.
Yeah. You have to do that as somebody that just does change outs, but, or I feel like you do, or you're not going to keep good employees.
No, you're right. All right. Well, look, man, appreciate you coming on the show. We covered a lot.
Yeah, we did. It's been a great time.
And we'll have to have you back on when you get your, when you're flying us somewhere.
That's it. Yeah. There it is.
Well, I think you guys could sponsor a plane. But the good thing is I won't have to change the name of the plane.
He learns quick, doesn't he?
Yep.
God. We call it Tailored Air Squared. Since I already got Tailored Air, I'm going to open up an aviation branch, Tailored Air Squared, and I don't even really have to change. I might even have to change the logo or anything. Just put a little plane at the bottom or something, you know?
There you go. Now, I am going to have to hit you up because I'm going to take a – I haven't gone out west as far as, like, a vacation-wise, and I've got a ton of credits I got to use. So I got to figure out – I want to take a trip out west. Yeah,
you got to go to Utah. It's awesome. I went there for my bachelor party. You can't beat it. If you go to,
I mean, what's the money time of year?
Depends on what you're going for. I mean,
and what if we do a Christmas time? Is that too much? Is it?
Well, I mean, some parks are closed. Depending on what you're trying to do. If you go into Utah, like southern Utah in the mountains, it's going to be snow. I mean, it's going to be a lot of snow.
Right.
So that's probably not the best time to visit Utah. But if you're going to Death Valley, I guarantee you there's no snow there. That's a pretty cool place.
It's not that It's not that bad in November.
No. Okay.
Not as
cheap. Well, yeah, I got one in. I got one in college and one in middle school. So their school like times off now don't line up. So yeah. Either it's like Christmas break or, you know, summer break. It's gonna stink now. They're not gonna line up. So.
Yeah,
we'll have to figure it out. I'll have to get away.
I'll shoot you some info. My wife's, she was a teacher, so she's got an itinerary. If you want a strict schedule on where you're going to take a piss at every time, she knows where to do it. But next time I'll figure out how to work my AirPods, I promise.
No, you're good. Hey, we'll get you a mic next time.
Yep.
Hey, I'm going to get you some Buffalo Trace over there real soon.
You better. Nope. I'm holding you to that.
All right.
Yeah. I'll let you have some of the wild turkey tree shaker.
Oh,
we'll
man.
Trade.
Yeah, well,
it's actually not that bad. It's pretty good.
That is not a fair trade.
Come on, man.
You're going to have to put a little with that.
Yeah. Well, I got some popcorn back here, too. I got one more left, so you better hurry.
All right. Well, cool, man. Be careful. We'll talk to you soon. Man. And
I appreciate it.
Yeah, good luck out there.
Appreciate it, Taylor.
Y'all, too. Good talking to you.
You too, brother.
Talk to you later.
Tomorrow brings, life's too short to waste it. I say bring on anything. I ain't here for a long time, I'm here for a good time. So bring on the sunshine, the hair with the red wine. Pour me some moonshine.